Hey, channel. Happy Friday to you. I'm Wes Elmendorf, Dealership Lighting Exchange, and what we're going to do is finish up wiring this exhaust fan. I tried to get the shot to where you could see all the different areas I'm going to be working in. Excuse the mess, like usual, most sheds, unless you're completely anal about keeping stuff perfect. There's always a mess in a shed. It collects over time, and you got to straighten it out every couple, 3 months, or in my case, sometimes every 2 years. So anyway, we already did the fan. You remember that part of the video. So here's where we're going to put our switches in, one switch, okay? And what I decided to do, I already have a three-gang setup over here. This is for my lights over top. The far right switch. This is for a front light that's on the shed that shines out towards the driveway out front. This is a rear light, which is a little 100-watt, two little 100-watt fixtures that shine off here. Now, had I planned ahead and been a good electrician and thought it out, when I put this in last year, I would have put a four-gang box in. That way, if I ever wanted to put another lighting circuit or a fan, which I didn't know I was going to do, I wouldn't have to tack one of these boxes next to it. And here's my plate cover. I haven't put a plate cover on this yet, or some of the receptacles down here. This one has one. So anyway, I have 120 volts over here already. It's on a dedicated 15 amp circuit, which runs the lighting circuit. It might even be 20. I haven't double checked it. But I'm going to pull my circuit straight out of here. I'm not even going to come out of the switch box and mess with all of that. I'm just going to come out of here, out of the line side of the GFI, not the load side, because it's a GFI. And I'm probably going to tack this box up high, because it's more of a utilitarian switch. It cuts a fan on. Now what I decided, and I was thinking yesterday, and last night a little bit, is I'm going to use a three-way switch. So even though a three-way switch is in its own capabilities and its specifications is made for controlling something from two areas, like a switch here and a switch there, it also has another purpose if you look at it. It has continuity from the black screw to one of these screws when it's down and not the other screw, the two brass screws. And when you flip it the other direction, it loses continuity or electricity from that screw and gains it on the other screw. So, if I take this, install it in my plate, and I put a label on here that says exhaust fan, and in the down mode, I can put auto, meaning the fan will come on automatically with the actual thermostat that's up in the rafters with it. And then when I want to flip it on myself, I can override it so it will say manual up top. And, of course, a label at the top would say exhaust fan or vent fan. So that way, it's controlled either way. So it's hot all the time when the switch is down, and it is calling for electricity, and it won't go to the thermostat by itself, so I don't have to wire it on the load side of the thermostat up there. So, and again, the only thing is with that, the thermostat, it has to be hot enough in here for it to cut on. So that's another thing that I got to look at, if this three-way switch is going to work or not. So anyway, basically I'm going to pull a piece of Romex from here, staple it up, mount this box here with the plate cover. It's just a couple of nail boxes. You guys have seen these in your local hardware stores in the electrical section. It's two little 12 or 16 penny common nails that run right through it. And you just hold it back up off of here. There's two little tabs that measure about 3/8 or a half inch back, and you just hold it up on here, and then you smack it with a hammer, run them all the way in, and you're good to go. Your wire goes into the little knockouts behind it, and then comes out, and then I'll go right up through here. There's already a hole here, a pretty good size 1 inch hole, and I'll run my three wire up on this rafter, and along this rafter here with a Romex connector that goes right into that exhaust fan junction box where the thermostat is. So that's pretty much what we're going to do. I'll do some of it and get started and get right back with you, Channel. Okay, Channel. A couple of small little tidbits I'm going to touch base on. I know we already talked about Romex connectors, just standard Romex connectors. I will be using a 12-3. It has one white, one red, one black. The black and red are hot, depending on how you switch them. White is always common or neutral. And the bare wire is ground. And again, a lot of that's just basic information, but if it's your first time doing some of this, it's just good information. Here's a Romex connector. I don't know if you can see that or not. It's got two little set screws on it, and it squeezes the wire. And then it has a lock nut for whatever you put it on, so it spins on and holds it to whatever fixture or device you're mounting it to. And then your trusty Romex staples, which look like this. So you're going to staple that to the wood. So again, I'm just going to run through this hole, across the top of here, along this one 2x4 rafter, up to my fan, and I'm going to strip. People do this different ways. They make Romex strippers. They get dull relatively easily, but I usually just use a razor knife with a really sharp blade with a flat surface and strip back about six or eight inches, depending on how far you're trying to get in the box. So again, like I could put it on my ladder here on a really flat area. Never pull it to your body. Obviously, you don't want to cut yourself. And just pull a nice little line. You don't want to push too hard so that you cut into the wire itself that's in the sheathing. And it just makes for a nice, simple peel back like so, right? And there's also a piece of, it's not really a strain relief, but it's a covering on the bare wire. You pull it back. And so you would just cut the remainder of this off, again, away from yourself, and don't strip the wires, like so, right? And then you get your Romex connector, you loosen your tabs up on it, your screws, run it like so. Got it like this, all centered up. This is plenty. You don't want so much because there's not a lot of room in that particular box. But it's better to have a little bit more than be too short. You know, what they say, measure twice, cut once. So you can't add wire to it. So just tighten them up. And another quick couple little things I want to mention to you. When you're working on electricity, right, you want to turn the circuits off. We've already talked about that. You want to make sure nobody's coming behind you. But if you have jewelry on, if you're a lady or if you're a man or whatever, whether you have rings or something, you have a wedding ring. I'm not necessarily going to be working on anything hot. I will turn the breaker off before I start working on this receptacle down here. Take your ring off. Either put it in your pocket, obviously you don't want to lose it, or put it on a keychain that you keep on your belt loop or something. You don't want any jewelry on your hands when you're working with electricity. Just common sense. It'll conduct if it's hot, and you'll get shocked. So anyway, we'll get right back. I'm going to go ahead and start stapling some of this and getting it pulled into the box. I've already mounted the box up here. I hammered it in like so. That's where my three-way switch will go, and I'm going to hit the load side on one side of the switch and leave the other side on the down part hot all the time to the line side of the thermostat. That way I can control it from here, and yet the fan will come on when it's in the down position all by itself. It won't affect the operation of the fan. So I'll get started nailing this up, and we'll touch base. Okay, Channel. So I'm just going to show you how I buttoned up. It's not tied in the electrically hooked up yet, but the Romex connector right here and the lock nut, because there's a half inch hole here that's cleared out, and you install it in there. Again, this is a three wire,
like I've already explained before. And so you staple it here nice and neatly, you know, keep it kind of straight the best you can. And I'm going to go down along this header, the top of this top plate rather, back here. And all the way down to that box right there that I mounted that's empty. So I'm going to set you up just over here for a second while we're finishing tying that in so you can catch a look at what's going on with how we get that done. So hold tight right there. We'll take a look and see how we're going to get this done. These are just standard steel Romex staples. They make them in different sizes. If you want to just be right up here, you can bend your wire to do what you want it to do. It's pretty pliable. And you want to staple it about every 16 or 24 inches. It's not like it's got to be, you know, nailed down so good. And again, it's hard to get up in here because your hammer don't have a lot of room. But obviously, this is important, and you know about what I'm going to say. Do not drive your staples so far in that it's going to pinch the wire and short the wire out. It's only rubber sheathing. And the wires in there are very close inside the sheathing. And even though it's very durable wire, it's not meant to be pounded on with a staple so hard that it pinches. Same goes for your connectors, your Romex connectors, when you tighten your screws that hold your connector together. Don't go crazy on your screws. Get it snug, make sure the wire's not moving, and then stop. That's all you need to do. You don't have to kill it. So we're going to go here. Another staple, probably in this rafter area, right? Have to turn your hammer sideways to get some clearance. Depends on where you're stapling your Romex. And don't hit your thumb to quiet the noise of the hammer. It always hurts. And another practice I like to do, you can hold the wire this way and pull it, since this one's already tagged, and get it a little bit more snugger so it's a nicer fit before you run this staple in. And you do that along the way. So now we're at this point over here. I've already pretty much know that I'm coming through this hole. There's plenty of room in this top plate. Watch me struggle now that you're watching. So we're going to drop it through here and we're going to this box. We're not going down to that box. We're going here because this is our load out to our fan. So I already know I'm going to put a nice little swale in this wire and dip down. You don't want it all, you know, playing the banjo and bent and not look good. Take pride in what you do. Get it like so. You know you're going to have to get a staple on this wood about like so. And you want about 8 or 10 inches out, depending on what you're working on your device. So I'm going to go right here. Obviously this wire is not hot, so I'm going to cut it across here. And there you go. Now, in the back of the blue boxes, which I could have shown you earlier, there's a little plastic knockout. It's got little tabs on it. You just take a screwdriver and bang it out. Sometimes you could just push it out. It's not like they're directional or anything. They don't hold the wire necessarily. Some boxes do. They have like a Chinese finger noose, kind of like those gray connectors I showed you before, where the wire goes in and it doesn't come out. Some of these boxes don't. They just have a square knockout. You blow it out and you drop the wire in. So again, we'll take that. And again, this is something, everything's about technique. You do it your way, right? There's a right way and a wrong way to do something. And there's also good technique in how to do something. So you obviously want to drop this down in here, right? Just like we said before. See how pretty that is? And get a little bit of a swale or a hump in it, right? You know you're going to need a staple back here. And we're going to go in the back left-hand corner of this box where I've already knocked it out. So before you pull it in there and start stripping it, you already know your measurement. Take your wire carefully with your razor knife. Do not open an artery or slice your wrists. Again, strip the wire how you want to. They do make Romex strippers, like I mentioned before. I'm just used to using a razor knife, and again, I haven't cut myself in a while, but today might be a new day. So, pretty much right about here, a nice, gentle slice with control, right? You don't want to hold the wire back here with your hand. Hold it up here and come down away, right? And then just, it's not that difficult. And it's nice and lovely strip job, right? You pull this off of here, get your ground out with that cardboard paper that comes with the Romex, get it loose, pull it back, it'll rip off, or hold all this up without this coming towards you, just whack it off, trash. This, nice and neatly, kind of put a little kick on this so you're not struggling, right? Get it started in your box. Come on through here, right? And drop it down in, like so. And remember, I already said I'm going to try to get a staple right here. You're supposed to staple by code. And again, I'm not a code expert, right? I've done a lot of work in a while, but they change the code from time to time. But fastening things within a box, I forget if it's 6 inches or 12 inches, but all wires are supposed to be fastened near a device or a junction box within a certain distance. Check your local code and your NEC code. Don't take my word for it. But I'm going to put a staple in it because it's my shed and I want to hold it. Right? See that? Again, don't go all the way. Don't kill it. Just snug it. Just so the wire's not dancing. That's all. All right, so that's that. So next I'm going to pull a regular 2-wire, because all I need is a hot from this receptacle up to here. And I will knock out, because I'm going to run along this rafter, the back left-hand corner of this box hole. See? The little tab comes right out. I don't know if you can see that or not. It's just a snap tab. It just snaps right out when you pound it. So we'll run that wire in a minute, and we'll show you. Okay, channel, we're back. So here's the situation now at this point. We have that box mounted. Now I'm going to take my Romex and tie it in right here. Okay? Staple it down along here. And again, like I mentioned before, I'm going to get my power from this receptacle. So obviously the shed is still electrified. Now I know what circuit runs that lighting circuit, so I could just cut that one off. Or as we spoke of before, you can cut off the main either in your house or whatever. So in my case, I have a 240 volt system on a 30 amp main that runs this little 4-space breaker panel. Okay, so I think number 5, and I'm pretty sure, is the one that is it. I've marked all these 1, 2, the main is 1 and 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and then here's the nomenclature up here for what the labels are. It's nice to make sure that everything's labeled properly. So just for safety's sake, I'm going to cut the entire main off in this shed. So we're going to go dark. Once I do that, no big deal. I'll set you back up on the stand over there, and I'll show you how we're going to tack that wire on down to that box. Lights out, main's off. No sense in turning the individual breakers off because the main's off. So again, hopefully you can see enough of what I'm doing here, and I'll just go over a couple things with this wiring that I'm doing now. So here's the situation, right? Be patient. All right, you can barely see into this view here. So make yourself comfortable wherever you're working, right? Even though sometimes the workstation in the area gets a little blown up, it looks like tools are everywhere and keep things neat or whatever, you're moving along, it means you're making progress. I'm getting older, I use a knee pad. I don't strap it on my knee or anything. I throw it down on the floor, right, wherever you're working, and use the right size screwdriver for your trim plate covers. Don't use a big one that's going to scratch up your covers, especially if you're doing something in a nicer home, not in a work shed. But it's just little things like that that you make sure of. Now again, the power's off, so we're going to take this receptacle and get ready to pull it out, okay? So, but right now, what I'm going to do is, I have a number two wire with a ground. So there's a black, a white, and a bare wire. Now, this fan doesn't draw that much electricity. I use 12 wire up here. It's not going to matter. It's going to get all the voltage that it needs. It doesn't draw a lot of amperage, the fan itself. So a 14 gauge wire will hold up to 15 amps. It's rated to 15 amps for something like 100 feet or 125 feet. You can check your specification books on your copper wire, right? So basically we're going to pop it up in here, right? Same thing we did for along here. We're going to feed it with a number 14 wire. It's not the end of the world. If I'd have had 14 gauge wire, I would have used a 14-3 up there, but this is what I had in stock. I wasn't going to go over to my storage unit and dig out 14. It's fine. So basically, same thing. You're just going to staple your wire along your stud, you know, within 3 to 6 inches of your box. Don't kill it. And we're going to go down to here. And again, just want it snug, but you don't want to ruin anything with the wire, the sheathing on the wire. So try to get your way. And I can use the hammer in the right direction this time. And she's snug and she's not pinched. It's not going to short. Again, nothing's on, there's no electricity. But I think what I'm going to do is come down, right? And then real pretty, you can do it one of two ways, kind of like a hook, and come upwards. You can also staple it over to this one to gain entry here. That way it's stapled within the box. So probably that's the best way to do it. Come over and then up. And then this will be plenty right here. I'll cut it. So, anyway. Now, you can take either a regular Phillips screwdriver or a straight, depending on how much time you have in your day. Or you can use a electric gun. You're backing your receptacle out, right? Pull it on out. Now this has been wired from before, obviously, for its service of itself. And it's tagged on what they call the line side. So we have to tag it on the line side as well. So what we're going to do is pop out this back hole over here, like I said earlier, like so. Now she's clear. There's the tab. And keep your wire flat. Straighten it out as you work. You know, make things neat. Even though it might be in the wall and nobody's going to see it, or it's in your shed or whatever. You know, anybody can do something and be a hack and do it all, what you call, you know, just don't care. And, oh, it's wired and it's running. It doesn't matter what it looks like. That's not true. You know, all circumstances are different, but you want it to be nice. You know? Now, don't get me wrong. Don't get me wrong. The electricity doesn't know if the wire is neat or not neat. It still works the same. But your eye and the people that see the work you do, that's what matters. So again, up here, through here, I probably could strip this first. Okay, and tag it like so. One on this side and one right there. See? Put one down here. All right. I don't want to waste a bunch of time showing you how to staple wire, but it looks like that's what's happening. So keep it somewhat level, nice little loop, and you're going to tag it. Try not to hit the knot in the wood. That's always a pain in the tuchus. Get it away from the knot of the wood that you're working with. Make sure your wire's flat when your staple goes towards it. Just like so, right? And then razor knife, good control. You don't want to open up an artery. Right in the middle of it, gently, right? put your hand behind where you're working out of the way, and pull down. Again, everybody's got their own technique. You use your technique however you're safe so you don't bleed. Pull all this off, get it like so, and then come back in here and get rid of the old sheathing. So, I'm going to button this up, tie this into the line side of it, black to black, white to white. Now, this is the speed connector. They're speed wired. So, I'm probably going to have to remove one set of wires, a black and a white, put a wire nut on each wire, and then put my new pigtails, the speed wire, in there. A lot of guys run it around the screw. That's fine. But these GFIs take up a lot of space. And to get them around the screws and push it back in the box, sometimes it's a little iffy. So I'm going to go ahead and continue to leave it speed wired, but put a black and white pigtail on it and tie my ground into my grounds. And same up here. So we'll get back in and I'll give you a visual on that. Okay, so here's the situation. Here's what we have. The circuit's hot now, but I just want to show you how it's wired. Okay, the blacks are tied to black with a pigtail that comes off and goes to the receptacle. And these actual screws on these GFIs tighten the wire. It's not a speed connector. Same with the whites and same with the grounds. And you should use a crimp sleeve and spin them around a good 8 or 9 times and make them all tight so you have them a good connection. We come up here to this switch. Now here's what I'd like to explain to you. This is a three-way switch. It's not usually used in this kind of application, but you can. So what I did was I found out, obviously, that the black screw, in this case, I'm going to use it as hot in. So I wrote an H on the side of the switch so I would know that's my 120 volts in. Now, the neutrals just go straight through. That's back there in that wire nut, okay? The ground gets tied together and crimp sleeved, and then gets mounted to this ground screw, which actually is this here, this part of the receptacle. It's grounded. Then on this side, when the switch is in the up position, I get continuity from this black screw to this brass screw that my red wire is hooked to, that I wrote M for manual, when I want to manually override the fan. Okay, and then the hot wire that goes to the fan all the time would be over here, which would be an A. I know my Sharpie kind of got blurred, but that means automatic. So if I keep the switch in the automatic setting up top, the fan has juice all the time to the line side of the thermostat, so the thermostat will cut on when it's met its temperature of degrees. And then the red wire, I will walk you up here, bypasses that and goes to the load side of the thermostat right here. So it's on the hot side of the thermostat. So it's like energizing this line that feeds this motor without going through the thermostat. So it's a pretty simple setup. I'm going to set you over here. I only have a short amount of time left. And I'll show you what I'm saying with all this. Okay. Switch is down, so the fan is on auto. So let me turn the thermostat down so you can see, because it's only like 65 degrees today. I'm going to rotate this down, and it should cut on. And it does. Now, if I leave it on 100 degrees, 120 thermostat, it doesn't matter. I come over here, I throw the switch up, my fan comes on. It pulls the circuit out on the line side going into the thermostat. So there you have it. So thanks for watching.